Good morning. Would you stand with us as we sing The Joy? I tell you what, this is a new song. You might not know the words, but thankful for the word of God that says, just make a joyful noise unto the Lord. So you don't have to sing it the right words at the right time, but just make a joyful noise in the room today. We will honor God.
Joy of the Lord is my strength. Joy of the Lord.
joy of the Lord is our strength. Go ahead and turn around, wave at somebody, shake their hand, tell them you're glad to see them in the house of God this morning.
Hold on, verse 2.
Good morning, church. How is everyone on this nice fall morning? Football's back. See Bill Bennett? He's the only one that has a football shirt on. Well, oh, there you are. Buffalo Bills. Yeah, Karen. All right. Well, welcome this morning. If you get your Connect card out, start filling this out. I'm just going to go over a couple announcements here, and we'll get back into worship. First things first. Annual church family dinner meeting is coming up on September 22nd. This is a very important meeting, especially if you're a member of the church, to be there and attend this meeting. They go over a lot of different things that are going on, and it's just important for members to be at that dinner meeting. Free dinner, soup, salad, bread. And then we also have coming up, men's conference is coming up October 18th and 19th. Early registration is October 1st. If you have any questions, you can see myself, or you can go on unstoppableconference.men, and you can register there. It's very simple to register. Just go in, and I will be getting details out as far as the hotel goes as soon as we know how many people are going, and we'll figure that out. But let's get back into worship.
Stand back up to your feet if you'd like.
Let everything that has breath,
that has breath,
praise the Lord,
praise the Lord,
praise the Lord,
praise the Lord.
Let everything. In the valley, I praise on the mountain. Praise the Lord, let everything.
Let everything.
That has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything.
Let everything.
That has breath.
That has breath.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. And you know, we can praise him on the mountain, right? And we praise him in the valley. We praise him because he's always good and because he's always, always faithful. He never fails. He never fails. No matter what you're going through, what you may be feeling, what you're walking through right now, God is with you. He's holding your hand and he's walking alongside you and encouraging you to stay steadfast and remain faithful to him because he is faithful to you. One of my favorite scriptures is in Lamentations 3. Lamentations, lamenting. And he was saying, so I say, my splendor's all gone. And all that I had hoped for from the Lord. And I remember my afflictions, and I remember my wandering, and the bitterness, and the gall. And I remember them well, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet, and this is where things change, right? I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we're not consumed. For his compassions, his love, his mercy, his grace never fail. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. Thank you, Jesus. Let's sing about that goodness.
I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. In all my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful.
Thank you, Lord.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, darker skies, the ghost like the water. I've known you as a father. I've known you. The greatness of God.
Sometimes people aren't faithful. You are. And Lord, because of your faithfulness, we choose to trust you. I don't know what anyone's going through, what your deal is, or what challenge you might be faced. We all have them. That song is a great reminder. Truth. We have to choose to believe truth. There is a God, and he's faithful. When I put him first, I can trust him. Thank you, Lord, that we can trust you. Lord, see us where we are. Lord, and build our faith. Lord, to go to the next step where you want us to be. We choose to trust you today. In your name we pray. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. At this time, our children are going to come in and our teens are going to come up, and we want to have a prayer over them as school has begun. And we're honored to have with us today Dr. Michelle Hartzell, if she would come at this time. And we are blessed to have a school superintendent that believes in Jesus, loves the Lord, is faithful to her church, loves her work and the kids that she ministers to. And she's going to lead us in a prayer over them. All our kids could come in, and all the teenagers, come on up. I know you don't want to, but all the students, even if you're in college, how about we're going to pray for all our students, college or beyond college, even if we want to pray God's favor and blessing over all of you as school has begun. As they're getting ready, I also have to acknowledge, I was away for a couple of weeks and just first week back next week, but we wanted to acknowledge one of our newest members here. Angie Yukon had a beautiful baby girl, Delilah Rose. Can we celebrate little Delilah today? I think she's in the back right now, right there in the back, yeah. St. Shirley's Hold, beautiful little girl. I also wanted to acknowledge, hate to leave everybody out, but we can't do everybody, but it was a special moment yesterday celebrating our good brother, 90 years old, Fred Miraglio. Yeah. And because she's my daughter, pastors get a little privileges. I have to mention my daughter Zoe turns 15 years old today. Yeah. Can we sing happy birthday to Fred and Zoe together? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Amen. We love you, Fred. We love you. Dr. Hartzell. Hopefully this doesn't squeal on us.
Good morning.
Just keep speaking.
Hello?
Yes. Are we good? Are we good? We got Mike?
Good morning.
Keep trying it. Just keep.
Good morning.
Hello, testing.
Hello?
Hold it closer.
Closer?
There we go.
There we go.
Nice and close.
Okay.
Right up there.
All right. Before we get started, I am honored and blessed to have such an amazing pastoral team, and all the prayer partners that we have in this church. They frequently send me cards and text messages, and I just want you guys to know how much that means to me personally. If you would ask me 30 years ago when I was a teacher in a classroom, if I wanted to be a superintendent of schools, I would have said, oh, no way. There's no way I would want to do this job. But God had a plan for my life. He put me in a leadership position. He created this pathway for my life. And I could not do my job each and every day if it wasn't for my prayer partners, my pastors, and my friends who pray for me each and every day. It's through God's strength that I can do my job, and I am blessed and honored to serve the children of our community. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these incredible children and the honor to guide and serve them. Lord, bless our parents and our guardians. Guide all the adults to let their eyes be open to the truth that if we do not teach our children to follow Christ, the world will teach them not to. Help us to guide them and train them in the way they should go. Jesus said, "Let the children come to me. Don't stop them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like children." Lord, please let our children be filled with your light that shines upon them and through them. Offer our children your love, protection, and peace. Give our children kind hearts. Help them to speak your words of truth to themselves and to others. Help our children to seek and make decisions that honor you. Thank you for being a loving and forgiving God, and let our children be filled with the Holy Spirit. Give our children the confidence to know they can be anything and do anything through faith, and let them know they are loved and they matter. Open their hearts to the truth and help them to always be guided by your promises. And when they struggle, please wrap your arms around them. And when they soar, give them the wings to fly, to share your message of truth. Lord, please let our children know that you are always with them. You love them, and they are protected by your promise of eternal life. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you for that honor.
If Dr. Hartzell would come down here to the middle, and if our students could gather around here, we're going to pray over our staff. If you're a school teacher, or administrator, bus driver, custodian, school official, would you stand? Homeschool teacher, if you would stand, we want to pray over all of you together at this time. Michelle, could you just move up a little few steps, and then make room for them to come all the way around you and lay hands on you? Any of the kids would come over and lay hands on Dr. Hartzell, teenagers. Don't be shy. Just gather all around her. She's got a tough job. Father, we thank you for our school district and the one that's here and those nearby and everyone who has prepared so faithfully to love on and educate our children. We want to ask you to be active in every detail of this school year, public, private, and homeschools. As we think of our homeschool teachers and public school teachers and administrators and support staff, we pray for the fruits of your Spirit to be evident in and working through each one, that there would be love for one another in the students, joy in the hallways, peace in the classrooms, patience with each other and those who challenge it, kindness and generosity for those in special need, faithfulness to their calling in education, gentleness in discipline, self-control when they're at their wit's end. May these things flow through every teacher and staff member in our schools. We pray you watch over their families, filling their homes with joy, peace, and good health. Help our teachers to communicate in ways that best encourage learning, maximize each student's giftings, and minimize non-essentials. For those without faith, we pray that you would cause faith in your own son, Jesus, to run rampant and grow in our schools. In a time when there are so many cultural shifts and never-ending challenges, provide wisdom for our superintendent, Dr. Michelle Hartzell, principals and the staff. Give them the kind of wisdom that directs them in ways that will honor you. We ask a special blessing of help and power and grace and direction for Dr. Hartzell. Surround her with a supportive team and give her favor as she does her best to juggle so many responsibilities in your honor. As she invites you into every meeting and conversation, decision and activity, walk with her in an intimate way. Help her to hear your voice in every situation. For you said the steps of the righteous are ordered of the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers. And all God's people said, amen and amen. We have one more little announcement to make. The kids can just stay where you are for a minute, I guess, or because you're, Rhonda's kind of working with the kids today.
Those poor sound guys are juggling a lot, but thank you, Jason. actually, at this time, I'm going to ask if Jim Fulmar could come up to the stage, and I know he doesn't really like this, but Jim, I need you to come forward, please. So we're going to end this little part of this with a little bit of a celebration. Jim has worked with the middle school kids on Sunday mornings with our middle school class called Fusion. It's a middle school small group. They meet during the service, and they have been meeting, come on up here, Jim, for a very long time. And Jim has led that group for 15 years, correct? 15 years. So a number of you sitting out there probably have gone through his Fusion class and sat under Jim. And Jim, you have sacrificed so much of yourself and given so much of your time. And I know many of the kids, I've talked to many of them, have come to their faith through you. And so we just want to honor you today for that. And for those of you who don't know, Jim also has given much of his finances, and he is known as Papa to many of the kids, or Pop Pop, right? Pop Pop. And every week he would bring chocolate milk and donuts. So today we brought you chocolate milk and donuts to honor you. So thank you, Jim. For 15 years, he's decided it's time for him to step down, and we appreciate the 15 years you have given to these children and the difference you have made in their lives. Thank you.
Thank you. You all may be dismissed, all the kids, maybe seated. Love you, Jim. Thank you for your faithfulness. I love my church family. If you're thinking that today, say a big amen. And I love my church family. Before we go forward, we are very, very excited and honored to be able to host a well-known evangelist couple, Greg and Robin Hubbard. They're going to be with us at the end of the month. And I just have a little promo video we want to show before we go forward, if we could show that right now.
Hey friends, evangelist Greg Hubbard here. Once again, we're so excited about these upcoming services. We are witnessing firsthand the power of God moving in meetings just like this. A few months back on a Monday night, Jesus opened the blind eye of a girl in New Holland, Pennsylvania. Just a few nights ago at our home church in Pennsylvania, saw numbers of young people around the altar crying out to God. Many were baptized in the Holy Spirit, reaching out, saying, God, here's my life. Take me and use me for your glory, whether for healing, salvation, encouragement, refreshing. We're believing God in the time that we're together for every life to be touched. I want to ask the students a special favor right now. I personally struggle in meetings if there are not students in every single service. I want to challenge you, not only on Sunday morning, but the Monday, the Tuesday, and the Wednesday, to pack out the rows of your church. Let's believe God together to move in a powerful way. We're praying for you, and we'll see you real soon.
Greg is an absolutely dynamic speaker, but beyond that, you know, there's speakers we can listen to all over the world. There's a special touch of God on him and his wife to lead people to faith in Jesus and to see them filled with the Holy Spirit and receive fresh touch from God. I don't know about you, but I'm in the mood for a fresh touch of God. Can you say amen? And so end of the month, it's going to be Sunday morning, Sunday night, Monday night, and Tuesday night. We want to encourage you to put that on your calendar right now. Block it all off. It's just going to be, they call their ministry Times of Refreshing. And that's what we all need. That's what our community needs. And so we're excited about that coming up. So be praying. There's a five-friend focus. Be praying for five people that you can be inviting to these services. I encourage you to do that. Let's go open up our Bibles, 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We're going to spend some time in the Word together. 1 Corinthians 10, continuing with our theme, As for me and my house. As for me and my house, we made some decisions. We've drawn the line in some things. Today's focus is, as for me and my house, we will avoid sending mixed messages about our faith. Whether it's at home or in the school or at work. In other words, everyone is going to know where we stand. Everyone's going to know that I believe in God, that I am a Jesus follower. His house is important to me. His word is priority in my life. We love God and his church. We believe Jesus died for us, rose again, and has a great life for us through faith in him. We love him above all else, and we don't want to leave any doubt, because sending mixed messages hurts our witness. As for me and my house, we will avoid sending mixed messages about our faith. Remember, through this letter, Paul is addressing problems and issues in a local church just like ours. He planted the church. He's been spending a lot of time in chapters 8, 9, and 10 on a particular disputable matter. Something they are arguing and fighting over. They're divided over whether or not it's okay to eat some meat that's been offered in worship to idols. And so he's spending 3 chapters. It must have been a huge problem, sort of like sometimes the challenge we have today in getting along over politics. This is a big deal they're trying to process. Is it okay or isn't it okay? He spends chapter 8, 9, and he's going to wrap it up here in chapter 10. Here's why it's a problem. In pagan worship, people would sacrifice animals to various gods, and some of that meat would be eaten by the participants, and some of the meat would be sold in the markets for people to buy for their dinners. Some in the church felt that since, hey, we know Jesus now, this worship is false, it's just idols or stone and wood, no big deal, we can eat the meat. But other people in the church disagreed. They felt that since the meat was part of a worship service to false gods, it would be inappropriate, it would send mixed messages about their faith and their true belief in the one true God. So what does Paul say? Well, quick review, chapter 8, he says, it's okay, and generally we all know it's just meat. That's fake stuff. Other gods aren't real. But keep in mind that your participation might cause other people to question your faith. It's going to send mixed messages. So in the end, it might be best just to abstain. Even though it's okay, just avoid the problem. You don't want to send a mixed message. So as we studied that, we said, as for me and my house, we will focus less on our rights and more on what's best for others. Giving up my freedoms can be the most loving thing I can do. Then last week, chapter 9, we saw that Paul gives an illustration of giving up his rights. He's practicing what he's preaching. He refused to take a salary for his ministry. He didn't want to send any mixed messages. His focus really was on lost souls, not the money. He didn't want to send a mixed message. So we said, as for me and my house, we will make sacrifices for the sake of the gospel. Making sacrifices is actually what empowers and increases our effectiveness when we're willing to make sacrifices. He was willing to give up eating meat. He was willing to give up taking a salary. It's a good example. So we asked ourselves, well, what sacrifices may God want me to make in order to help more kids and teenagers and moms and dads come to faith in Jesus? Is there something that I should stop doing that's getting in the way, or something that I could start doing to help share the gospel? And then with that thought in mind, I want to pause for a moment to update you on our parking lot project. We've been talking about it for a while now. It's been a journey. The latest is we've got the drawings, we've got approvals. We're waiting on the water retention plan. And so they got to figure out where all this water is going to go, how we're going to take care of it. So they're still working on that. And then once that gets approved, we work with our contractors. Latest I heard, they thought we could still maybe get it done before winter. That would be our prayer. And everybody said, please, amen. So the goal is we want to expand, pave what has not been paved out here where people are parking already, and also go west and east further, add a lot more parking at our main entrance. And then also we'll have some up here. We're going to add a couple rows up here, so there'll be much more parking. We have the theme that we're using, pave the way. So beyond paving the way for more parking, in actuality, what we're doing is paving the way for more people to experience our ministries. We're paving the way for more to hear the gospel, paving the way for more boys and girls to come to faith in Jesus. Or paving the way for people to come back after they've been a while. Our hope in all this, we never do pressure giving campaigns. You know that we don't celebrate the offering enough. We want to start doing that even more. It's a big part of what we do, and it's our worship to the Lord. But as you know, we've been very low-key even on our approach to offerings. But for this project, our simple request is that everybody in the room would ask God, hey, would you like me to sacrifice something for the sake of paving the way? So there's a card in your bulletin. It's simply a small amount, big amount, whatever you feel God leads you to do. If you could let us know, we know what we can count on that may come in. And so it's a faith promise that I'm going to try to do this amount within a year. And so we just ask every teenager, every single person, every married couple, if you would consider turning in one of these cards with any amount. Our goal is by the end of October to receive as many cards as we can, and that'll help us know where we are going forward. In the end, we have the money to pay for the project. That's the good news. The bad news, it's still in your pockets. Okay. Yeah. So we can do this. Okay. Now back to our passage here. So I hope that was understood. So it's simple. Just ask God if he leads you for an amount for a year. Put it on the card. By the end of October, if you could turn that card in, it would be very helpful. Back to chapter 10, Paul continues to address. the issue of eating this meat. In chapter 9, as I said, he gave a positive example of making sacrifices. He gave up his salary. Now in chapter 10, he's going to give a negative example. He wants the church to learn from this negative example. He'll share how their ancestors abused their rights and they suffered the consequences for it. He didn't want this church to experience the same thing. Unlike what their ancestors did, he wants them to say, as for me and my house, we will avoid sending mixed messages about our faith. Verse 1. For I do not want you to be ignorant of the fact, brothers and sisters, that our ancestors were all under the cloud and that all passed through the sea. They were all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. And the nation of Israel was blessed, he's telling them. They were in a good place. Things were going well. God brought them out of captivity in Egypt. They were slaves. He brought them out. Now they're free. He walked them through the desert with a cloud by day and a fire by night. He was with them. He was guiding them. And I hope you know that today. He's with you. Your steps are being ordered. We don't have that cloud, but we have his word. We have his voice. He speaks and he leads us. He takes care of us. So they were in a good place. And just as we are united in Jesus by water baptism, it unites us. We get baptized in the water. I'm aligning myself with Jesus. They were united together under Moses' leadership in the events of the Exodus, going through the Red Sea. It says, baptized into Moses. They knew God was their deliverer. God is our deliverer. Whatever we need delivered from or into, he is our deliverer. Not only that, he says, they all ate the same spiritual food and drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that accompanied them, and that rock was Christ. Again, he's going back to the nation of Israel. Remember how God provided the manna, spiritual food. He provided water out of a rock, spiritual drink. Notice that rock was Jesus. This is a foreshadowing of Jesus being the living water that we all need. Makes me think of the Hubbard's ministry, times of refreshing. They're good at helping people experience the living water. And again, they were doing well, but they end up sending mixed messages about their faith. That's where it went wrong. Verse 5, nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them. Their bodies were scattered in the wilderness. He's referring to how only Joshua and Caleb got into the promised land. Afraid of the giants in the land, the promised land. You remember that? Remember our study on demons and giants? We walked through all that, and they were scared, and they lacked faith. As a result, God says, well, you're not going in. And it's estimated a couple million people. They ended up wandering in the desert for 40 years. A whole generation is killed off. The bottom line is God is disciplining them. Why? They exhibited a lack of faith and trust. Their life choices sent a mixed message about their allegiance to God. Hey, are you really committed to the Lord or not? Now look at what Paul says in verse 6. Now these things occurred as examples to keep us from setting our hearts on evil things as they did. Unlike them, church, he's telling them, as you process eating this meat, don't end up sending mixed messages about your faith. That's the point he's making. Don't be like the Israelites who sent mixed messages about, are you in or you aren't? Do you really believe or don't you? Are you a person of faith or aren't you? Don't send mixed messages when it comes to this decision. And in that, he shares four ways to avoid sending mixed messages I think we can all relate to. The first way, he says, is usually I like to give application points and the positive. I try to do that. But today I'm going to give them in the negative. And that is number one is don't commit idolatry. Do not be idolaters as some of them were, as it is written. The people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. This is a reference to their ancestors building the golden calf. You remember that? When Moses was getting the Ten Commandments on the mountain, they turned from worshiping God to worshiping a golden calf. If that doesn't send a mixed message, I don't know what does. I was serving God, now I'm worshiping an idol. I'm here, ready to receive from God, and I'm also here worshiping an idol. Makes me think of sometimes we've had this experience and we're all learning and growing. There's a teenager on Wednesday night and I'm here in God's house and I believe in God. Then I'm sneaking away in the bathroom to make out with my boyfriend. You're sending a mixed message. And everybody said, don't commit idolatry. Paul's point is, hey, don't do that. Don't put anyone or anything in the position only God deserves. That's idolatry. Now, none of us are likely to go out and start worshiping an idol. But it's common for us to allow other things or other people to get the affection, to get our time and energy, to get our focus and value, to get our trust for happiness. That only God deserves. We can allow our love for other things or even people to overshadow our love for God. And that's idolatry. In their case, some who were indulging in eating this meat were putting their desire for it above their desire for God. That's idolatry. Things today that have the potential to become idols for us are relationships. I know God's probably not in favor of this one, but I'm going for it. I put this above God. Sports, money, substances. I'll be happier if I do this rather than just trust in God. Possessions, power. If your life shows that you are more passionate about anything than God himself, be careful you aren't becoming an idolater. You don't want to be sending mixed messages. This is Paul's point. In the book of Hosea, chapter 2, idolatry is likened to adultery. In other words, idolatry is cheating on God. So Paul says this to the church family, brothers, sisters, search your life, search your actions, how you're living, look at your thoughts. As you decide about eating this meat or not that's been offered to idols, don't end up committing idolatry. Make sure God is first. And then the second way he says to avoid sending mixed messages about your faith is don't commit sexual sins. This is a big one, we all know. This sends major mixed messages about your faith when you choose to engage in sexual sin. When you say you love God and his word, and you're engaged sexually with a boyfriend or girlfriend before marriage, you're sending mixed messages about your faith. And let me say, you're not only sending mixed messages to other people, you're sending them to yourself. And then you're always living questioning your own faith. There's no confidence in it. Message. It creates chaos is what it does. Verse 8, we should not commit sexual immorality as some of them did, and in one day 23,000 of them died. God killed off 23,000 people. And you know, we know committing sexual sins, immorality includes any form of sexuality, sexual activity before marriage, fornication, includes committing adultery, it includes homosexuality, all sexual sins. God says sex is to be for one man and one woman in marriage alone. And all God's people said, we believe that here. When you engage in any sexual activity outside of marriage, you're sending a mixed message about your faith. And sadly, I struggle to even say this, but many mainline denominations today are blatantly doing this. Blatantly approving of homosexual leaders. Paul says, let's learn from our ancestors. And in one day, 23,000 of them died. Makes you wonder, that's why so many of our mainline denominations are dying today. Three, he says to his church family, don't put God to the test. Verse 9, we should not test Christ. Some of them did and were killed by snakes. How many snake lovers in the room? I just love snakes. I feed them rats every day. It's my thing. Some people do. You like snakes. I'll tell you a story about snakes. So I have an exterminator that's a person you call to your house to help get rid of animals you don't want in your house. I got bats in my house. They fly around my dining room, my living room. And so we called an exterminator to help us get rid of our bats. And we were having a good conversation, and I happened to ask him, hey, what is one of the most interesting visits you've had on your job? And he told me probably the thing that stands out the most to him is he found a 6-foot snake in somebody's piano. Yeah. Stay away from the piano. Okay. So anyway, that was his story. Well, this refers to testing Christ is questioning God's goodness and his plans. Don't push against the God who created you, the God who leads you, and he protects you and provides for you. The Israelites were frustrated with their desert journey, and they spoke against God, and they spoke against Moses, God's appointed leader. So God sent venomous snakes. Think of it. The only way to live was to look upon a bronze snake that God told Moses to hold up on a stick. And so while he was disciplined, he provided a way of salvation. Look at the snake on this stick, and then you would be healed, even if these snakes got at you. And again, it's another foreshadowing of Jesus on the cross. When we look to Christ, he saves us and delivers us. Paul's point to the church, hey, when you question God about his guidance in your life, and we all do this at sometimes, and you question his provisions because he hasn't given enough or what you want, you constantly battle against what he wants for you to do, you're sending mixed messages about your faith. When you're pushing against him and not falling in line, you're testing him. And when you do that, you're sending mixed messages about your faith. And then number four, he mentions, and don't be a complainer. Anyone know a complainer? Don't point, okay? Don't point. Seems all they do is gripe about something. Nothing ever's going right. Woe is me. Everything's bad. No one around them can do any good. They just gripe and vent about everything. You know someone like that? One time my brother Joel, I called him to talk to him about something. He goes, you need to quit calling me. It's always bad news. I was going through a season where he called me out on that. The truth is, we all fail sometimes when we do that. we're sending a mixed message about our faith. I thought you believed in God. Do you trust him or don't you? Are you trusting he's with you and he's faithful or not? When you complain, you're sending a mixed message about your faith. Verse 10, and do not grumble as some of them did. They were killed by the destroying angel. The people of Israel didn't seem to realize. They couldn't see God was setting them free. He was making them a nation. He was taking them to a better land. They couldn't see it because they were wrapped up in what he wasn't doing for them. They missed the Egyptian food where they came from. And they grumbled about the manna. Being a complainer sends mixed messages about our faith. Paul wrote, these things happened to them, church. What things happened to them? The discipline, the killings, as examples, and were written down as warnings for us, on whom the culmination of the ages has come. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Hey, church, as you process what you'll do about eating this meat, offered to idols, or any other disputable matter that you're processing, is this okay to do or not to do? As you're processing that, remember these things about our ancestors. If you think you are right and determined to stand up for your rights, be careful that you don't fall. There are four ways you need to avoid sending mixed messages about your faith. Don't commit idolatry. Don't commit sexual sins. Don't test question God at every turn. And don't be a grumbler. Keep these things in mind as you process your decision. Keep these things in mind. Now Paul transitions and he encourages them with the issue of temptation. He makes it clear that all of us struggle with temptations. Again, the context is tempted to do the wrong thing with the decision of eating this meat. He says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. Everyone deals with temptation. And God is faithful, and he will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. So you can get this right. He's going to help you in your decision-making and your strength to do what he wants you to do. But when you are tempted, he, God, will also provide a way out so that you can endure it. And God is faithful. He'll not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. That phrase makes me think of, we've all heard this phrase, God won't give you more than you can handle. That's not in the Bible. And I don't even think it's true. Okay? This verse is a little bit different. It's talking about temptation. I think he actually does allow us to experience things that we can't handle. So we trust in him. When it comes to stress and temptations, it's more than we can handle. But not more than we can handle with him. When we're with him, we're trusting him, we're walking with him, he will give us a way out. When we are putting him first, we can trust whatever temptation, he'll give us a way out. He'll do it. Therefore, he says, my dear friends, flee, run! From idolatry. Run away from anything that might send a mixed message that this is more important to you than God is. Run away from that. Run away from anything that causes you to give all your energy and passion to over what God wants from you. Flee from it. I speak to sensible people. He's encouraged them. You guys are sensible. Judge for yourselves what I say. Is not the cup of the thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body, for we are share in one loaf. He's talking about communion and how it unites all of us and how it's a participation spiritually with Jesus. In other words, isn't it true, he says, when we have communion, when we take the bread and the cup, we are uniting ourselves with Christ. And we are also uniting ourselves with each other. We're eating the flesh and drinking the blood. We are uniting ourselves as one, one with the Father. It's a spiritual act. So that's communion. Now he's going to switch to how the same thing is true when they eat meat offered to idols. You're uniting yourself something here. Even though idols are just wooden stone, because those who do this are offering worship through sacrificing animals, the meat is part of an act of worship. So he says, consider the people of Israel. Do not those who eat the sacrifices participate at the altar, the act of worship, uniting themselves? Do I mean then that the food sacrificed to idols is anything, or that an idol is anything? No, it's just wooden stone. It's just that. But the sacrifices of pagans are offered to demons, not to God. If they're worshiping something other than God, the alternative is Satan, demons. He says, and I do not want you to participate with demons. So on one hand, he already said, eating this meat offered to idols is not a big deal because you know it's just false gods. Go ahead and eat as long as you don't cause people to stumble. But on the other hand, you can see why it takes three chapters to talk about this. On the other hand, though, he says, this meat has been offered as a part of worship. And any worship not to the one true God is idolatry. And if it's not to God, then it's actually uniting with demons. Because if you're not going with God, you're going with the enemy. And I don't want you to be part of uniting yourself to demons. We could broaden that whole teaching because that could include any sin. Any sin we choose to engage in is participation in the demonic wanting us to get away from God. And so we're uniting ourselves with the demonic when we engage in sinful activity and putting other things more important than God is. Verse 21, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord, uniting yourself to Jesus, and the cup of demons too. It's sort of like you can only serve one master. You can't serve two masters. You're either all in with God or you're not. You're serving the enemy. You cannot have a part in both the Lord's table and the table of demons. Are we trying to arouse the Lord's jealousy here? Because you're giving attention to demons rather than God? Are we stronger than He? Now listen, I have the right to do anything you say, because you're free in the Lord, in Jesus. I can eat this meat, he says, but not everything's beneficial. I have the right to do anything. I'm free in Jesus. I'm under grace. But not everything is constructive. You might have some freedoms, but it's not beneficial. It's not going to be helpful to you. No one should seek their own good, but the good of others. So again, what should they do about this meat offered to idols? Because on one hand, it's just meat, but on the other hand, it's been part of an act of worship. Here's Paul's final conclusion. He's wrapping it up after three chapters. He speaks in terms of it's just you buying this meat. Eat anything sold in the meat market without raising questions of conscience. In other words, you don't have to run an idolatry test every time on every item. Don't stress over it, for the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. So everything in it certainly includes that leg of lamb in the butcher shop, so go ahead and eat. Now, on the other hand, if an unbeliever who doesn't understand faith in Christ is involved, and they invite you over for a meal that includes this meat, he says, if an unbeliever invites you to a meal and you want to go, eat whatever is put before you without raising questions of conscience. Go ahead. Again, don't stress over doing an idolatry test. It would be both bad manners and bad spirituality to cross-examine your host on the ethical purity of each course that they serve you. You don't need to get into all that. Just go ahead and eat what they serve. But if someone says to you that this has been offered in sacrifice, in other words, they go out of their way to let you know that it's been offered to gods and goddesses, then you should pass. He says, then do not eat it, both for the sake of the one who told you and for the sake of conscience. Now, it has become a matter of conscience. Even though you may be indifferent as to where it came from, he isn't. And you don't want to send a mixed message. There are things that we feel are okay, but if it's going to send a mixed message, we want to avoid it. Verse 29, I'm referring to the other person's conscience, not yours. For why is my freedom being judged by another's conscience? If I take part in the meal with thankfulness, why am I denounced because of something I thank God for? So for me, it's no big deal. But for their conscience, and then when all is said and done, here's Paul's conclusion. We're finally going to get off this topic. Okay, 3 weeks of eating meat to idols. When all is said and done, here's the climax of his advice and his conclusion. Here he goes. So, with all this being said, whether you eat or drink, that's your decision. Or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. Do not cause anyone to stumble. People are watching. You don't want to send mixed messages. Don't want anyone to stumble, whether it's Jews or Greeks, people outside the church, or the church of God, people inside the church. Don't send mixed messages. Even as I try to please everyone in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many. Why? So that someone might get saved. Harsh reality, and it's a challenge for all of us. We all at times send mixed messages about our faith. You have to keep in mind, as Paul taught here, that can interfere with other people's faith. And actually, when we give ourselves to it, even claiming to believe, it affects our own faith. And then we have a hard time believing I'm okay with God. And so as for me and my house, we will avoid sending mixed messages about our faith. People are watching. My kids are watching. Whether it's at home or in the school or at work, we put our love for God above all else. And whatever we do it for the glory of God. Would you bow your head? Question. Are your life choices sending a mixed message about your faith? We can all probably identify an area of our life where, boy, I do kind of complain. I'm engaged in things I shouldn't be engaged in. Let's bring that to the Lord Jesus. Thank you for your word and the reminder of how important it is, the choices that I make. I want to say I'm sorry for sometimes sending mixed messages. Man, I just do the wrong thing. I say the wrong thing. I'm sorry. I come to you in faith, believing, trusting. Forgive me. Forgive me. Today, strengthen me. Strengthen me to keep you first in everything that I do. Strengthen me. Empower me today through your Holy Spirit. Cause me to live in a way where others cannot even question, boy, they love God. They serve the Lord. The Bible's priority in their life. Holy Spirit, cleanse us and make us more like Jesus. Would you just stick your hand on the shoulder of a person next to you? Say a little prayer over them for strength. Strengthen them, Lord. Strengthen them, Lord. Holy Spirit, cause them to desire to put you above all things. Give them that desire, Holy Spirit. Only you can do that. And give them strength as they live for you in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you all.